Good morning. We are having a journal club today. There are two topics related to gastric cancer. The first will be presented by Dr. Milind Alokji, who is a first year JR at MR Bangur Hospital. And Dr. Orkopabu Rai will carry on the discussion today. Okay. So I'll ask Dr. Milind to start, please.
Good morning, sir. Good morning, respected teachers and my seniors. The journal club, the topic that I'll be presenting today is combined surgery and extensive intraoperative peritoneal lavage versus surgery alone for treatment of locally advanced gastric cancer. This was the C plus randomized clinical trial. The primary author was Jingu, and it was published online on March 27, 2009. Now, this was published in the Journal of the American Medical Association Surgery, JAMA Surgery. The editor-in-chief is Melina R. Kibb, and the country is the United States of America. The frequency of this journal is 12 issues per year. The other publications by the primary author include thiopurines prevented surgical recurrence in patients with Crohn's disease after intestinal resection, and other studies that he has done on gastric cancer, including combination of CRP and NLR, a better predictor of postoperative survival in patients with gastric cancer. Now, introduction. Gastric cancer is the fourth most common diagnosed malignant neoplasm and the second leading cause of cancer death. The standard treatment that is followed in case of advanced gastric cancer is resection followed by chemotherapy. And the most common pattern of postoperative recurrence is peritoneal metastasis. Now, this happens by the direct cancer cell dissemination from the cancer that involved the serosa layer. The prognosis of patients with peritoneal metastasis is extremely poor, with a median survival time of 3 to 6 months. Now, two therapies are available to tackle the peritoneal metastasis. One is intraperitoneal chemotherapy. Now, this is given via loco-regional chemotherapy and cytoreduction of numerous malignant neoplasms. But the value of intraperitoneal chemotherapy is debated, as some studies show that it does not have any impact. It is costly and there is increased rate of postoperative complications. The second therapy that is available is extensive intraoperative peritoneal lavage. Now, this is similar to the limiting dilution approach. Kuramoto et al. In 2009 showed that a combination of EIPL and IPC reduces the number of intraperitoneal free cancer cells to potentially zero in advanced gastric carcinoma. But the safety and efficacy purely of extensive intraoperative peritoneal lavage has not been defined well. The aim of this study was to demonstrate the safety and efficacy of extensive intraoperative peritoneal lavage. Now, this was a multi-center parallel group randomized trial with 11 participating hospitals in China, held from March 2016 to November 2017. And there were 550 participants. The appropriate ethical committee clearances were taken and candidates were given written informed consent. Now, the preoperative inclusion criteria included participants aged between 18 to 80 years. The ECOG performance status was 0 or 1. Written informed consent was taken. It was they consented to an open surgery. And the preoperative evaluation was clinical T3, T4, NEN, and M0 according to the AGCC 7th edition. The intraoperative inclusion criteria was macroscopic appearance in exploratory laparotomy of clinical T3, T4, NNE, and M0, and a margin negative resection. Exclusion criteria included previous neoadjuvant chemo radiotherapy, peritoneal dissemination, distant lymph nodes, massive ascites if the patient is participating in any of the clinical trial, if there is a severe cardiovascular, respiratory, or any other system involvement, and poor compliance. Now, we see the patient flow here. Initially, 662 patients were randomized into two balanced groups. Post-surgery, if in pathological involvement was, or if there was a T1, T2 disease after pathological involvement, or if there was M1, the patients were, they were excluded from the trial. And finally, there were two groups of 271 and 279 eligible participants. Now, randomization was done in 1:1 ratio by the participating center. And this was done through sealed opaque envelopes that contained computer generated random numbers in the procedure to which the patient was allocated. Where, and these envelopes were opened after the laparotomy was done. All the patients underwent an open curative D2 gastrectomy and achieved margin negative resection. And depending on the primary tumor, the surgeon performed total, proximal, subtotal, or distal subtotal gastrectomy. And a standard operating procedure was predefined and given to all the surgeons. And all the surgeons had sufficient experience for D2 gastrectomy, more than 100 procedures per year. After potentially curative operation, EIPL was performed. Now, in the surgery alone group, conventional peritoneal lavage was done using less than 3 liters of physiological saline. And in the surgery plus EIPL group, 10 liters of physiological saline, 1 liter for 10 times. Every time the peritoneal cavity was stirred and washed and the fluid was completely aspirated. Now, all the patients were recommended to undergo 8 3-week cycles of oral S1 and intravenous oxaliplatin. And they received chemotherapy for 2 weeks, followed by 1 week of no chemotherapy. And this regime was interrupted if there was any potentially serious or life-threatening adverse effects. The short-term operative complications on mortality was noted. Mortality, one of the parameters, which was death within 30 days or during the hospital stay. Complications such as ileus, abscess, hemorrhage, or leakage. Pathological findings, abdominal pain, and the other such parameters that will be discussed. Major bleeding was defined as hemorrhage more than 300 ml. Ileus, abscess, leakage were diagnosed by clinical suspicion. Clavien-Dindo classification was used to assess the severity of post-op complications, and pain intensity was assessed by a numerical rating scale with a score more than 3 was considered to be equivalent to pain. Appropriate statistical analysis was done. Now, firstly, the baseline characteristics. We see that in both the groups, the mean age, the number of male and female participants, the BMI of the patient was without any significant difference. The tumor location also was evenly distributed. Pathological T category, pathological N category, were also basically both the groups. This was a well balanced. Both the groups were well balanced. And the baseline criteria for the cancer was taken as a Borman classification. Now, when we see the surgical outcomes, we see that the distal gastrectomy was done in majority of the cases in both the groups, and time to flatus and postoperative hospital stay were not significantly different. The other postoperative laboratory results were also not significantly different. Mortality was the 5 in the surgery alone group, 5 patients had a mortality, 1 due to intra-op bleeding, 3 due to respiratory failure, and 1 due to heart attack. Whereas in surgery plus EIPL group, there was no mortality. Abdominal pain was also significantly, there was incidence of more abdominal pain in the surgery alone group, and patients with at least 1 post-operative complications were also more in the surgery alone group. Now, specifically, if we see the presence, there were more patients having ileus, more patients having intra-abdominal abscess and intra-abdominal bleeding in the surgery alone group. Now, the findings in the present study indicate that EIPL decreases the incidence of post-operative complications. When compared with previous clinical trials, the rate of intra-abdominal abscess after gastric surgery is somewhere between 1.3 to 17%. And this is higher than what has been observed in the present study. Further, the authors note that EIPL appears to minimize the risk of surgical infection, and they infer that the EIPL reduces the amount of intraperitoneal damaged tissue and wound exited and cleans the peritoneal cavity. Now, EIPL, by reducing the inflammatory response, significantly decreases the postoperative pain. It has been noted that the inflammatory response through cytokines is mainly responsible for the pain. And because of the peritoneal lavage, the bacterial material which is removed, which promotes pro-inflammatory cytokines, and metabolic waste and tissue debris is removed, which decreases the local inflammation. Also, the rate of ileus in the EIPL group appeared lower than that of the surgery alone group, and this is also consistent with other published result. Reduction in the postoperative inflammatory reaction avoids adhesion formation that results in ileus. Now, death in the surgery alone group, 3 patients died due to respiratory failure and 1 due to heart failure. It has been noted that the deaths are associated to these the deaths that involve the respiratory or a cardiac compromise are due to upregulation of the inflammatory reaction and postoperative pain, as has been found by other researchers also. And EIPL reduces this inflammatory reaction or the inflammatory cytokine that is there, and therefore it can lead to reduction in the respiratory failure and heart failure cases. Intra-abdominal bleeding, 7 patients in the surgery alone group as compared to 3 in the EIPL group, EIPL may help to potentially identify bleeding more easily by sufficient stirring and washing of the abdominal cavity. Now, the study limitations include that the quality of the study may be decreased because 112 patients were excluded because of their T1, T2 or M1 disease, but the balance of both the groups was not changed, and there was no objective inflammatory reaction measure was collected. Now, this study was the first to show that EIPL significantly reduces short-term post-operative complications, wound pain, and mortality associated with D2 gastrectomy. EIPL can increase safety and result in early recovery post-operatively. As a new, safe, and simple procedure, EIPL therapy is easily performed anywhere and does not require any special devices or techniques. It is a promising and exciting therapeutic strategy for patients with advanced gastric carcinoma. Now, we'll just quickly look at two other similar studies. One was the CCOG 1102 trial in Japan. This was also a multi-center randomized phase 3 trial. And this included 295 patients. And they concluded that although EIPL for advanced gastric cancer was safe and suggested some efficacy, their primary endpoint design based on previous small-scale trial was not met. Similarly, the EXPEL RCT, which was done in multiple Southeast Asian countries such as Korea, Singapore, Japan, this was also a randomized phase 3 trial including 800 participants, and they concluded that EIPL does not show any survival benefit compared with surgery alone and is not recommended for patients undergoing curative gastrectomy for cancer. Thank you.
So 3 to 4 things I want to ask you. Yes. So as it is a journal club, so first of all, what you conclude from this particular article regarding its feasibility in application in our centers?
The approach that they have talked about is a simple approach. It is simply giving a extensive peritoneal lavage. Sir, I feel that this approach can be tried in our centers because it can be easily performed in our centers. It does not require any extensive new equipment or any other new addition to the setup that we already have, sir.
Okay, number two is, if at all, because even though we are all the medical colleges in the West Bengal are taken as tertiary care hospitals, but as the very new hospitals are growing up, medical colleges, so if at all it can be practiced in our setup, if it can be, it has to be universalized. So what are the changes, if at all, you want to do in trying, in an attempt to apply this protocol in our setups, if to make it a universal one for all the government hospitals, medical colleges, not government hospitals? So what basic things you should have to introduce here?
Basically, Dr. Arpova, what I'm trying to say is the current recommendation for gastric cancer treatment is, if you have a locally advanced disease, there is a role for giving neoadjuvant chemotherapy.
Yes.
So simply because that you have a T3-T4 lesion, going for upfront surgery is not the recommendation at the moment. Mm. So there is a role for giving neoadjuvant. What they're showing here is they have not studied the long-term outcome. Here, the thing they have studied, the parameters are immediate post-op outcome in the form of pain. Because you see, if you do extensive lavage has some, one of the thing was bleeding. You see, if you have achieved good hemostasis, if you give extensive lavage, sometimes the occult bleed may be revealed. So that is one part that you manage that. But if you say that as a whole, the incidence of post-op bleeding in gastrectomy is not very high, and that is not the leading cause of death in post-gastrectomy patient. So this is a study which gives some other parameters of outcome in the post-op period. But for oncological point of view, the current recommendation is for T3, T4 tumor, you should go on for neoadjuvant and then consider for curative surgery. So this can be applied in patient with local advanced tumors, and these are the factors which causes less pain, less infection, less incidence of posterior bleeding. So on that point, I hope that this is not a difficult study to carry out, because it is just a simple lavage. There is no special technique for that. So this
with extension of what you have spoken just now, regardless of any journal club. So three things the resident should keep in mind when they are concluding the journal club. They at least speak about three things: whether the journal is or article is new in concept, whether it is true, that is what you are saying, that yes, it can be easily performed, that is true, and if there is any changes that can be made to make it feasible in our setup. So these are the three things you should at least speak while residents are going for journal clubs. In any topic, not in case of CS Tomoc, in any topic. So thank you. It's good presentation. Nice one. Is there any other comment?
Yeah, we can pass on to next, Dr. Komal.
Okay.
Kamal, you have to unmute yourself. Kamal, you are not audible.
Am I audible, sir?
Yeah, you are audible now. Yes, please start.
Yes, sir. Good morning, respected faculties. My topic for journal club presentation is surgery after intraperitoneal and systemic chemotherapy for gastric cancer with peritoneal metastasis or positive peritoneal cytology findings. It was published by Hironori Ishigami, received on September 30th, 2016, accepted on 15 December 2016, and published online on 27 December 2016. It was published in Gastric Cancer, which is a joint official journal of the International Gastric Cancer Association and the Japanese Gastric Cancer Association. According to the result of pivotal clinical trial, the combination of S1, that is that includes chemotherapy drugs tegafur, gemcitabine and otoracil or capecitabine with cisplatin or oxaliplatin was recommended for first-line chemotherapy, and paclitaxel plus ramucirumab recommended for second-line chemotherapy for according to Japanese gastric cancer treatment guidelines. Combination of chemotherapy and surgery is now regarded as an option, but the strategy of gastrectomy followed by chemotherapy failed to provide a survival advantage compared with chemotherapy alone. Another approach was conversion therapy, that is using chemotherapy to downstage the tumor and then aiming at an R0 resection via surgery. The advantages are that chemotherapy is administered to patients in better general condition than post-op patients, and surgery is performed only on responders to chemotherapy. The gastric cancer patients with peritoneal metastasis or positive peritoneal cytology findings are generally treated with systemic chemotherapy. However, considering the unique mode, transgenomic mode of spread in peritoneal metastasis, it was reasonable to approach the metastatic lesions and free cancer cells directly using intraperitoneal chemotherapy. It was seen that intraperitoneal paclitaxel provides a high local concentration over a long time because of specific pharmacokinetic properties. A regimen was designed combining weekly intraperitoneal paclitaxel with systemic S1. And in a phase 1 trial, the dose of paclitaxel was determined to be 20 mg per meter square. It was a retrospective study consisting of 100 patients. Place of study was University of Tokyo Hospital, and the time was between 2005 and 2011. Inclusion criteria included gastric cancer patients with peritoneal metastasis and or peritoneal cytology findings positive, who were already treated with intraperitoneal paclitaxel plus S1 and IV paclitaxel. And the exclusion criteria included patients who underwent non-curative gastrectomy for palliation before the initiation of chemotherapy. The patients were made to undergo diagnostic laparoscopy with peritoneal cytology. Intraperitoneal was implanted in the subcutaneous space of lower abdomen with a catheter placed in the pelvic cavity. Combination chemotherapy of intraperitoneal paclitaxel plus S1 along with paclitaxel IV was initiated approximately 7 days after the laparoscopy. S1 was administered twice daily at 80 milligrams per meter square per day for 14 days, followed by 7 days of rest. Paclitaxel was administered intravenously at 50 mg per meter square and intraperitoneally at 20 mg per meter square on days 1 and 8. Paclitaxel was diluted in 1 liter of normal saline and administered through an intraperitoneal port 1 hour concurrently with intravenous infusion after standard pre-medication. This course was repeated every 3 weeks, mainly in the OPD. Tumor responses were evaluated after every 3 courses by CT and upper GI endoscopy. Cytology of ascites or peritoneal lavage fluid was collected through the intraperitoneal performed, and the Pap stain was performed at the end of each course. Gastrectomy was considered when a remarkable response to chemotherapy had been observed. The indication criteria were negative peritoneal cytology findings, disappearance or obvious shrinkage of peritoneal mets, and no unresectable metastasis identified by diagnostic imaging. The response of the peritoneal metastasis was evaluated by second look laparoscopy, the timing of which was determined by consideration of extent of peritoneal metastasis before chemotherapy and the response to chemotherapy. Gastrectomy with lymph node dissection was performed when tumor was resectable by standard or extended gastrectomy, including pancreaticoduodenectomy or thoracotomy. Splenectomy was performed in patients with suspected splenic hilar lymph node metastasis or peritoneal metastasis of the gastrosplenic ligament. Distal part of pancreas, colon, small intestine or admixture was resected when direct invasion of primary tumor or metastasis was observed. When white nodules or scar-like lesions remained on the parietal peritoneum or mesentery, they were dissected or ablated as much as possible with electrocautery. Extended peritonectomy or intraperitoneal intraoperative chemotherapy with or without hyperthermia was not performed in any patient. The same combination of chemotherapy regimen was restarted after surgery as soon as possible with appropriate dose reduction. Intensity and duration of chemotherapy were determined by the attending physicians in case in each case, considering the curability of surgery and post-operative decreases in chemotherapy tolerance. The assessment and statistical methods, the baseline characteristics of patients who underwent surgery and who did not proceed to surgery were compared by Pearson's chi-square test or Fisher's exact test when appropriate. The extent of peritoneal metastasis was classified according to the Japanese classification of CA stomach 12th edition. P1 indicated metastasis immediately adjacent to the stomach. P2 indicated several scattered metastasis within the peritoneal cavity. and P3 indicated numerous metastases throughout the peritoneal cavity. The histological response of the primary tumor was classified according to Japanese classification of gastric carcinoma, 14th edition. Grade 2 was no evidence of effect. Grade 1A was visible tumor cells occupying 2/3 or more of the tumorous area. Grade 1B was viable tumor cells occupying 1/3 to less than 2/3 of tumorous area. Grade 2 was viable tumor cells occupying less than 1/3 of tumor area. And grade 3 was no visible tumor cells. The overall survival rates were estimated by the Kaplan-Meier method, and the overall survival rates of groups divided according to extent of peritoneal metastasis, residual tumor status, or histological response were compared with the log-rank test. P-value of less than 0.05 was considered significant. Results. Out of the 100 patients, 68 showed remarkable clinical response and were considered for surgery. Of these, one patient declined surgery and second look laparoscopy was performed in 67 patients. In 65 of these, disappearance or obvious shrinkage of peritoneal metastasis was observed. In these 65 patients, laparotomy was performed and gastrectomy was performed in 64 of them, as one patient was found to have pancreatic and duodenal involvement. The patient characteristics between the patients who proceeded to surgery and who did not show adequate response to chemo were compared. The mean age of patients who proceeded to surgery was 57, while that of patients who could not proceed to surgery was 59. This was not statistically significant. The sex ratio was also not statistically significant. The ECOG performance status. In patients who underwent surgery, the ECOG performance status was 0 in 49 patients, 1 in 15 patients, and 2 in none of the patients. And for the patients who could not proceed to surgery, the ECOG status was 0 in 19 patients out of 36, 1 in 15 patients, and 2 in 2 patients. This was statistically significant. P-value was 0.015. Previous chemotherapy, out of the patients who proceeded to surgery, 28 patients had received previous chemotherapy, while the ones who did not proceed to surgery, 15 patients had received previous chemotherapy. Macroscopic type, patients who proceeded to surgery, out of those two, one patient had ulcerative type of growth, 22 patients had infiltrative ulcerative type of growth, and 41 patients had a diffuse infiltrative type of growth. While those who did not proceed to surgery mostly had a diffuse infiltrative growth. Undifferentiated carcinoma was seen in 51 of 64 patients who proceeded to surgery, while it was seen in 25 of 36 patients who did not proceed. Extent of peritoneal metastasis for patients who proceeded to surgery, P0 CY1, that is only cytology positive, was seen in 8 patients. P1 was seen in 3 patients, P2 in 18 patients, and P3 in 35 patients. The patients who could not proceed to surgery, 30 patients had P3 metastasis. This difference was statistically significant. The outcomes of surgery, out of the 64 patients who underwent surgery, 58 patients underwent total gastrectomy and 6 patients underwent distal gastrectomy only. Combined resection of spleen was done in 19 patients, distal part of pancreas in 3 patients, colon in 13 patients, small intestine in 2, and adnexa in 8 patients. Lymph node dissection D1 was done in 37 patients, D2 in 26, and D3 in 1 patient. 4 patients developed postoperative complications. 2 patients having anastomotic leakage and 2 having pancreatic fistula. Residual tumor status, 44% of the patients underwent, 44 patients out of 64 underwent R0 resection, 10 patients underwent R1 and 10 patients underwent R2 resection. Histological response, grade 1A, was seen in 35 patients, and while no viable tumor, grade 3 was seen in only 2 patients. The overall survival of patients who underwent chemo, who underwent surgery, was compared with the patients who did not proceed. The mean survival time in patients who underwent surgery was 30.5 months, while that in those who did not proceed to surgery was 14.3 months. The difference in mean survival time was significant between patients having only cytology positive or P1 disease compared with P3 disease. There was no significant difference between the three groups of residual tumor status, but there was a significant distance between the survival of patients who underwent surgery when graded according to the histological response. Grades, patients who underwent grade 2 and 3, who underwent surgery having grade 2 and 3 of histological response showed better survival. Relapse or progression was observed in 58 patients out of the 64 with a median time of 17 months. The first site of recurrence or progression was the peritoneum in 38 patients and other sites in 26 patients. In 6 patients, it was seen in both sites. The site of metastasis other than the peritoneum included lymph nodes, liver, bone, ovary, pleura, adrenal gland, and meninges. The site of recurrence or progression was not associated with histological response of the primary tumor. The results suggest that surgery after response to chemotherapy has chemical efficacy, although median survival times of these patients who underwent surgery and who did not undergo surgery are not comparable because of difference in baseline performance status, extent of peritoneal metastasis, and response to chemotherapy. This combination chemotherapy regimen would be much more effective for peritoneal mets other than for primary tumor or other metastasis because of higher concentration in the peritoneal cavity of paclitaxel. The rationale for surgery is to resect the primary tumor when peritoneal metastasis is well controlled and thereby prevent new metastasis, bleeding, or stenosis that may be caused by the primary tumor, which may lead to prolongation of survival. In that sense, surgery in P2 and P3 patients might not be definitive conversion surgery. Meanwhile, surgery might cause progression of residual disease, apparent or occult, because of perioperative pausing of chemotherapy, postoperative decrease in tolerability of chemotherapy, and a postoperative reduction in antitumor immunity. Thus, surgery should be performed after the peritoneal metastasis is sufficiently controlled or eliminated if possible, and excessive surgical stress and postoperative complications should be avoided. 10 patients were seen to have R1 residual tumor, microscopic residual tumor, and 10 patients underwent R2 resection, but there was no difference in overall survival compared with patients who underwent R0 resection. This result indicates that residual peritoneal tumors can be controlled by postoperative continuation of intraperitoneal and systemic chemotherapy with a remarkable shrinkage of peritoneal lesions, suggesting a possible benefit of gastrectomy. Since peritoneal lesions were similarly controlled in those patients with a poor histological response, this suggests that response in the primary site might be dependent mainly on sensitivity to systemic chemotherapy. Therefore, it may be reasonable to change the postoperative regimen and use systemic drugs with the same intraperitoneal chemotherapy regimen. Judging from the results of this study, the overall strategy and treatment can be regarded as appropriate. However, some patients develop progression soon after surgery, and it is important to know for which population surgery was effective. It is clinically suggested that the extent of peritoneal metastasis and response to chemotherapy are associated with the prognosis of patients, but the analysis of prognostic factors is difficult since there are no accurate and precise methods to quantify these two factors. In conclusion, surgery after response to intraperitoneal and systemic chemotherapy is safe and may prolong the survival of gastric cancer patients with peritoneal metastasis or positive peritoneal cytology findings. Thank you.
Thank you. It's an elaborate presentation, though it is a multimodal application of different things. So one ask you, is there any further study or further article where you can see that regarding P2 and P3 lesions, whether molecular targeted therapy will be preferred over peritoneal intraperitoneal therapy. Is there any article? Have you searched for that?
No, sir, I'm not aware of any such article published in the literature.
So, in case of locally advanced tumor, gastric carcinoma, the depth of penetration of intraperitoneal therapy is much less than what it does with the different types of molecular targeted therapy. If it is more than PT2B and PT3, then molecular targeted therapy will become first according to newer guidelines. And even if now, regarding what is practiced in colonic and rectal surgery, the debugging of the tumor, that has also coming into practice in case of stomach cancer. Though upfront surgery is the best curative approach, but in case of late stage disease, sometimes molecular targeted therapy followed by surgery can benefit to the patient, not for survival, but for the regarding the quality of life. So there are different trials for intraperitoneal chemotherapy and different trials for molecular targeted therapy. Even different trials are still going on. So whenever you are taking up this particular topic, whether it is intraperitoneal therapy and molecular targeted therapy, both have came as a long questions. You should know the different trials, which 7 to 8 trials are there. Some of them are already been rejected, and some are going on with the three trials. And some has already been published their data. So that things you should keep in should be keeping in mind, because these things can come as long questions also. So this intraperitoneal chemotherapy and molecular targeted therapy for advanced carcinoma of stomach has come as a long question many times. So not only for general purpose, for your practical and theory purpose, you should at least know these things. Okay, is there anybody to comment? Okay, I conclude this session. Thank you all.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you.